Hello, boys and girls, it's Uncle Night Shift, and tonight we're gonna continue painting and weathering the T-90 and in fact finish it. Now, if you're not caught up on this mini-series, this is a 1/72 scale model from Revell, and it's one of the worst kits I've ever built in a very long time. I tried upgrading it with a few homemade improvements, but the final product was still not ideal, but I decided to push on and try painting it. What I'm trying to replicate is a T-90 used in Syria, because, yeah, big news. Russia sent a few of them over there, and I decided to loosely recreate one specific tank which was painted in a plain green color, because I'm very lazy when it comes to that, and I'll take a single color camouflage over anything every day. Last week we left off somewhere in the middle of the painting process, so tonight we're gonna jump right in and finish it. Okie dokie lookie, my friends. Let's start with a throwback to the previous video. Yeah, there's a lot of obvious stuff to finish, like painting the sandbags, which I'm totally not looking forward to, and also all the small surface details like optics, lights, and so on. Yeah, those are not fun, so let's get them done first. I mean, not the sandbags, but the optics, lights, and so on. Luckily enough, those can be all painted with a dark gray color. I'm trying to keep this model simple, so I won't be creating the effect of depth behind the glass like I did on my previous models. Before I started though, I had to look up photos of the real tank because almost every glass piece has a different tint. Some of them are clear, and for this I used Wet Effects Fluid, which is a simple enamel gloss varnish, and because those parts are recessed, it flows nicely around corners, so it's very easy to apply it. It also doesn't react with the acrylic dark gray color, so it's truly an easy step. The remaining ones won't be as easy because I have to use lacquer-based clear paints, and these can, and in fact will, dissolve the gray color, so it's important to work fast and try to avoid touching the surface with the brush. I usually place a small droplet of paint on the part and move it around without actually touching the surface. With all of these sparkly bits out of the way, I should probably paint the dreaded sandbags, but I won't do that, yet. Instead, I'll have some fun with this side of the turret, which was hit by an RPG, but the tank survived thanks to its paste armor, which was blown off during the impact. And at the same time, I'll give some love to the end of the gun barrel, which has the thermal wrap removed for some reason. Does actually anyone know why Syrians don't like the thermal wrapping on gun barrels and why they are always completely charred and grimy? If you have any info on this, please let me know in the comments, because I have no clue why it happens, I'm just blindly following real life photos. So the basis for these effects is gonna be burnt stains acrylic from Life Color. I wanted to apply it with a sponge, so I prepared quite a lot of it, and don't get me wrong, it actually did the trick, but I found it to be quite inefficient and slow. Probably because I thinned the paint down too much with tap water, so I quickly switched to paintbrush and applied it in multiple layers of random shapes. I was simultaneously working on the gun barrel, but I'll show it to you after we're done with this part, so that we don't have to jump back and forth between shots. So, the next effect is incinerated white, again from Life Color. Both of these paints come from their burned diorama set, but I kinda lost the remaining colors, and these are the only ones I still have. But yeah, incinerated white is like an off-white color, it's not your regular white color. Next on the menu were some remnants of the original tank color, which I mixed from the same colors like in the previous episode, and I brushed them randomly in a few places. Now please keep in mind that photos of the real tank that I'm recreating don't show this area very well, so I was kinda freestyling and using another photo of a destroyed T-90 as a reference. Now for some obligatory rust washes, and yeah, unfortunately I can't just drop those photos in here because of copyright reasons, which I hope is understandable, but if you search Syrian T-90 hit by RPG, I'm sure you'll find the ones I'm talking about. I'm also aware that an ordinary RPG impact looks quite different, usually a tiny hole with a lot of gray soot around it, but I think the fact that this grenade was stopped by the spaced armor resulted in this kinda burnt surface. And yeah, speaking of burnt effects, I'm gonna pull the Mickey Mantle trick from one of his seminars. So I'll spray the area with the chipping fluid, the usual way with two light layers, and then with matte black from ammo. Now, I just like to say that this might be the worst choice of color one can make, and I only used it because I don't have any flat black from Tamiya. And I originally wanted to edit all of this out, but this kinda shows you how much time I spent just trying to get the paint out of the airbrush. I mean, no matter how much I diluted it, I couldn't make it to spray in a controlled manner. It was either nothing or a massive load of black, as if my airbrush was having a bad case of explosive paint diarrhea. But after 4 minutes of trying different trigger pulling techniques, I was finally able to release the Kraken and I actually managed to spray it where I wanted. Even though the paint sprayed horribly and it didn't actually spray, it was more of a splatter, but this was the least of my concerns because I was going to chip it anyway. Tap water will activate the chipping fluid, which will then allow us to remove the paint in a very authentic looking way. And the resulting effect and texture is definitely a sight to behold. But I wanted to fix a few doo-doos, so I grabbed the black oil paint and blended it in a very similar way like those rust washes a few moments ago. Well, I guess the result is quite a looker. It almost looks like the real thing, even though I kinda misplaced it because the burnt spot on the real tank was more towards the middle of the panel, but I think it's good enough. And like I said, the same stuff happened on the gun barrel. Initially I expected and planned to use different techniques here, but after looking at photos it seemed almost identical to that burnt turret effect. Now, again, I don't know why this happens in real life, but my theory is that these tanks see a lot of action and almost no maintenance, especially on their gun barrels, so they'll eventually deteriorate. And the bore evacuator develops a leak and it will start spurting gases and smoke in both directions. I don't know, I'm just theorizing, but I still don't have any theory on why Syrians don't like the thermal wrapping. But anyway, let's now paint those sandbags. The original ones are white, I presume they're regular civilian, you know, agricultural bags used for grain, just filled with gravel in this case, and so I painted them with the incinerated white. I only applied one layer of diluted paint, leaving some of the green showing through, and I have no idea why I did it, but I really liked how it looked. If you've been around on my channel for a while, you probably figured that I don't use much stowage on my models. Well, the truth is, anything that can be defined as stowage, aka tarps, bags, personal crew items, or pretty much anything that's not made of steel is like my arch nemesis, and I have the most irrational fear of adding stowage to my models. I guess we can call it stowage phobia. And so I just avoid it. I purposely choose tanks with no cargo. I actually use the word cargo, so I won't say stowage again. And when the rare occasion presents itself, my stowage painting skills are as good as my jokes when I'm trying really hard to be funny, which is now. So I used oil paints, just like the last time on my KV220-2, and in this case it was pure white for highlights and two tones of gray, a light one and a slightly darker one, for shadows. I have absolutely no idea how to place lights and shadows, so I won't mislead you with my BS, and instead I'll show you the result of my struggle. Yeah, they look more like rocks. And I used the same methods on the dust shroud. This one was actually painted with the rest of the tank, which makes it look more unique, but also more challenging to distinguish. And here I used olive drab oil paint mixed with buff oil paint for the highlights, and olive drab with black brown for the shadows. Here I must say that the result actually ended up looking pretty good, and I think it's because the shroud has more texture and wrinkles, so it's actually, you know, easier to paint. Anyway, the model is now ready for some actual weathering, and because desert weathering has been up there in the top 10 most requested things on this channel, I hope I won't disappoint. Now, I think it's been a while since we last used real earth for weathering, but I have a very specific idea for this model, and real dirt will be perfect for that. Again, if you've seen at least a few pictures from Syria, one thing will pop up immediately. Well, a couple of things. First, those tanks are beaten up so bad they look like zombie tanks, and second, they're often covered with tons, don't take that literally, of dirt and rubble. It depends on the environment. When they're fighting in cities, they're covered with rubble, and if it's in the countryside, it's dirt. I wanted to recreate something in between, so a little bit of earth and a bit of rubble as well, and when the model is small like in this case, we can use just plain old earth. When working larger scales, I find it better to recreate rubble with something more authentic looking. For example, small broken pieces of plaster, cat litter or actual bricks, like 1/35th or 1/48th scale bricks and cinder blocks. And I think we'll be looking into that in the near future on another model. So anyway, after I was happy with the placement, I fixed the dirt with gravel and sand fixer. This is the third time that I'm using this product, and I've already gotten the usual "why you not use white glue" comments, and hey, if that's your thing, I'm fine with that. I used it before in the past, but white glue isn't as strong as this. It can be weakened by plain tap water, and it spreads really bad because of the surface tension. This fixer spreads beautifully on its own, and it partially melts the underlying paint for a short while, so it creates a very strong bond between the dirt and the model. The only way to dissolve it is by using enamel thinner, so we're mostly gonna use acrylics to simulate dust. But before we get to that, I'm gonna take these two paints and pick out some of the larger clumps of earth with them. This is gonna simulate the broken pieces of concrete, rocks, or house facades, and also bricks. Like I said, painted earth wouldn't exactly do the trick in bigger scales, but for this purpose, I think it's gonna be just fine. So the rubble and dirt is now pretty colorful, but the upcoming dust effects will tie it all together and make it look like the real deal. The dust in my references is very pale, so I went with the light matte aquiline paint from Wilder. This is the acrylic reactivatable paint which can be blended with water. Working with it is very easy, and yes, I'm starting with the running gear, but don't worry, we'll get to the upper surfaces in no time. And what makes it easy is that it can be reactivated at any moment, no matter how much time has passed since you applied it. It blends differently than enamels, and it's easier to remove too much while blending, so I like to apply it much heavier than I would normally do with enamels. And because I had to glue the tracks to the model before I even started painting it, I'm just gonna weather the entire running gear as one single unit. So, now I'm blending it with tap water, and I'm just letting it flow around all details and crevices like a dusty wash. The fact that I pre-dusted these parts with an airbrush in the previous episode helps to make the effect more opaque, and as such, this whole process is much faster and easier. As you can see, I also applied it on these parts which come into contact with the wheels. I mean, those parts of the wheels come into contact with the tracks. Again, the power of checking your references. And also, tracks in the desert stay surprisingly rusty, like I had a very hard time finding an example where the tracks were polished. And I'm completely okay with that. At least I won't have to spend more time polishing them with a pencil, and it'll be another small thing that will make this model look different from the others. Here's a good example on how easy it is to blend the effect even when there's obviously too much applied. If I wanted to go for something heavier, I might need to use less water while blending, or I could pre-dust these side skirts with an airbrush and Tamiya paints. It's also possible to layer the aquiline on top of itself, but it's kinda tricky because we're gonna reactivate the previous layer, but it's doable. Another option would be to use enamels on top of this sort of initial layer. No, so acrylic initial layer and enamel top layer. But then again, this is the effect I was after, so I don't even know why I'm coming up with these alternate solutions. And if you thought the aquiline on the side skirts was too much, then this is gonna be pure nightmare fuel. But at the same time, it's kind of interesting because technically we could just dip the entire model in a pool of diluted aquiline and then wipe away the excess. Which might actually be more efficient and time-saving solution. But anyway, the point here is to let the real earth absorb the paint and leave a faint smooth trace around it, which will create this natural smooth transition between the dirty and clean parts. It will also tone down the painted rubble, which might be a good thing or a bad thing depending on the effect that you're after. So after I was done with the dusting process, the model was actually looking pretty nice, which is quite shocking if we consider it's a Revell kit. And some of my patrons were actually telling me to call it a day at this point. But there's one very interesting effect which is very common in desert environments. And I wanted to try it out for a very long time. And I also like sharing new ideas with you, so I couldn't miss the opportunity. So I mixed an earth-colored enamel paint with light rust wash into this ugly color that looks like rusty water. And I applied it in a few places over the previous dust layer. Now, this effect represents moisture trapped in the dust, and it happens quite often in the desert. At least I think, I'm no dust scientist by any means, but I'm just going with what I see in photos, and the only time I see this effect is either Syrian or IDF tanks. Maybe it's a Middle Eastern thing, maybe it doesn't happen, let's say, in Northern Africa. I'm honestly not sure, but it definitely looks... well, when you compare it to the more usual style of weathering, it's something different, that's for sure. One thing I actually like about it is that it adds more contrast to the overall dull, dusty surface, but without making it look like another muddy tank. And of course, I would never miss a chance to add some obligatory oil and grime stains, and again, I used dark wash for that. I kept it rather simple. For example, on the fuel tanks, I only added it around the filler caps to increase the contrast, and then only around this oil cap. There's one photo with a Middle Eastern gentleman checking the oil levels and the oil is spilling everywhere. It's just like it's slowly crawling its way out of the tank and covering everything. It looks pretty cool. And the most obvious place is under the exhaust, which is a trademark of all tanks made in Russia. People already explained the reason behind this back in the KV220 series, and it's because the engine seals have a tiny bit of tolerance, so the engine will work properly in all temperatures. And as a result, there's always a very small oil leakage, which is then spat out of the exhaust. And with this out of the way, the model is finished! And let me tell you, ladies and gentlemen, this was a very fun project. At first, while I was building it, yeah, it wasn't so fun back then, because this is seriously the worst model I've built in such a long time that I can actually safely call it the worst kit I've ever built. But the painting, especially some of the less usual techniques and highly unusual order of their application, had a very high fun factor. But hey, the series might not actually be over yet, because I'm thinking about a small scenic base for this model. But before you get any crazy ideas, no, I'm not gonna build an entire street with collapsed buildings or some high-level diorama. The truth is that I haven't done anything like that in a very long time. I think more than a decade. So my skills are pretty much non-existent. So my idea is to make something as simple as it gets, without making it too boring, of course. And I have a few photos saved for inspiration. But hey, maybe it'll end up as a total disaster and the model will end without a base. But even if that happens, I'll definitely post a video about it the next week. Because if nothing else, we can at least have a good laugh at my expense. So anyway, until that happens, let me thank you for watching all the way to the end. Also, a very big thank you to my amazing patrons who make this weekly show possible. And if you'd like to help me spit out these videos every week, then maybe you might just check it out, because I'm offering a lot of rewards in return, such as almost daily photo updates, which are like a real-time blog from my workbench, also 1 week early ad-free videos, also very large and nice photos which you can download in full resolution, and we can also talk through DMs. Anyway, I think that's all I wanted to say, so thanks again, my friends, I wish you an amazing weekend, and before you go, don't forget to give the video a like if you enjoyed it, or a dislike if you hated it, and I'll catch you again the next Friday. Cheers!